So this is our the series we're coming in right now, the cross. The table, the cross, and the empty tomb. We remember the table is, we were thinking about the table as table fellowship, which kind of culminates in Jesus spending his last supper with his disciples, all of whom would desert him. One would deny him by calling out curses on himself. You know, may God strike me dead if I know Jesus. That's a good friend, eh? And then one who betrayed him to his death. And then, but Jesus still welcomed them. And so Jesus welcomes us in our brokenness. We don't have to get right to get to Jesus. We get with Jesus, and Jesus begins to do his work on us. And the second thing is this profound display of love that is the cross. And what we looked at last week was that the cross tells us that God has made everything right between us and God. And God's not counting anything against us like that or anything. And one of the things we looked at was that there are different ways that the church in history has looked at the work of the cross. And so we saw that some of the ways seem to make more sense to different groups of people at different times and things like that. And we're going to look at the empty tomb a little bit that way too today. I have to give you a little teaser. You can hear it for the whole sermon. But we're going to get somewhere later, and I'm going to say something. I'm going to offer you something that is undeniably true. Undeniably true. And some of you are going to go, duh. And some of you are going to find it a little unsettling. And some of you are going to find it a great relief. So, that's where we're going. But here's where we're beginning. The empty tomb. Our faith, the Bible says, is in the resurrected Christ. That's the cornerstone. That's the linchpin. That's the thing that sets the Christian faith apart from Judeo-Christian philosophy and ethics. The belief in the resurrection is what makes Gandhi not refer to himself as a Christian. Mahatma Gandhi said he was a follower of Jesus, but he didn't believe in the resurrection, and so he wouldn't identify as a Christian. So, for my mind anyways, and everybody has to figure out where they are, where they're at, and all that stuff, but for my mind, it's the empty tomb, really, that defines, is this person a Christian or not? And that's not a judgment term. When I say that, I'm not saying, is this person going to heaven or not? Or does God love that? I'm not in a position to make any of those judgments. What I'm saying is that from the very beginning, it is the empty tomb that defined this movement that was originally called the Way and only later called Christian. So our faith is in the resurrected Christ. When Paul was trying to...
I'm going to blank that for a second so you don't read it while I'm talking.
That's what the speaking coach is saying. When Paul was in a place where they had no Jewish background at all, it's a place called Mars Hill. This is where all the philosophers met to discuss and talk. And it was surrounded by statues of different gods. And then they had one statue that said to the unknown God, because they realized they didn't know everything, and they were at least wise enough to know they were ignorant, right? That's a good place to start for all of us. Be wise enough to know that we are ignorant. And so Paul has a chance to talk to people who have never heard anything about Messiah or prophecy or anything else. And when Paul gets a chance to talk to these people, he doesn't begin with Isaiah, Jeremiah, or the Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? With Jesus' words on the cross. He doesn't begin in any of those places. Where he begins is with the resurrection. He says, I see you guys are religious, you're serious about life, you want to go after truth, and you've got all these gods, you've got one idol here for the unknown God. I want to tell you, I want to fill in your ignorance. Basically, that's what he says. And then he tells them just a little bit about Jesus, that there is a God, and in fact, all your gods are kind of bunk, because if there's really a God, then it's not something you made, it's something that made you. And then he goes on, this is the ending part here, he says, this one who made you all, who's not like an idol made by hands, has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man he has appointed. And of this he has given us assurance to all by raising him from the dead. So that is the crux and the core of everything. It's not, Jesus taught awesome stuff, he did awesome things, but the crux and the core is the resurrection from the dead. In fact, very early in the church, I'm going to go back to that later. When Paul was talking to his brothers and sisters in Christ in Corinth, he wrote this: if Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain. So we can't gloss over or sort of downplay the resurrection of Christ in the Christian faith. It's the center and the core of Christian faith. But it's also quite an amazing assertion that somebody rose from the dead. If they didn't, everything is as it seems, because people don't rise from the dead. But if he did, then everything is different than it seems, because someone did rise from the dead. And in fact, Paul tells us that the Christian faith is this way. It's that our trust is in what is not seen. In fact, Paul tells us what is not seen is more real than what is seen, because what is seen is going to pass away. You, me, the building, the chair, the earth, whatever, it's all going to pass away. But what is unseen now is what's going to endure for eternity. And so, the resurrection of Jesus. And I want to walk through a little exercise that we did on Easter Sunday in a briefer way, talking about why we believe in Jesus actually rose from the dead. And I want to equip you at the same time to be able to talk to other people about it, if that's something you come to believe in. Because Paul tells us we need to be ready to share with other people why we have the hope. Why are you a Christian? Well, I think Jesus rose from the dead. Well, why do you believe Jesus rose from the dead? Well, the Bible tells me so. Well, that doesn't do much for someone who doesn't believe the Bible is the Word of God, right? I mean, so you have a book that you say is special, and it says that Jesus rose from the dead. Woo. Let's go get lunch. But it's a lot stronger. It's a lot stronger than that. I want to give you a way to talk about it, hopefully even a way to remember it. And the acronym we're going to work with is SWIM. Because sometimes when people ask you why you're a Christian, it feels like you're sinking. You're like, I know, I can't quite explain it. And I want you to be able to swim. I want you to be able to swim boldly when you have a chance to talk about Jesus, and especially the resurrection of Jesus. So here's our little acronym, SWIM. And we're going to address different criticisms, different reasonable, very reasonable points of skepticism with regard to the resurrection. So we have the account, and we're going to get back to that account in a minute. That's going to come up, so don't worry about that. But first of all, some people say, well, maybe they stole the body and set it in the graves, right? That's one thing that some people say. That's the S. S is the stolen body. So let's talk for a minute about the idea that the disciples of Jesus stole the body. Okay? Let's see if that's reasonable. Because after all, this is a fate. It's not going to be like locked down ironclad, but it should be reasonable. It shouldn't be like believing in fairies. It should be believing something that at least has some reasonable evidence behind it. So, let's examine the idea that the disciples stole a body. Well, first of all, there was a Roman guard. And you've got to picture each one of these things in your mind, because they're going to build quite a strong case by the time you get to the end. Picture Roman guards. They are paid and trained troops. They have armor. They have helmets. They have swords. They have shields. The disciples are a few fishermen, a tax collector, and a handful of other. I mean, it's almost like the group Motley Crue was named after the disciples, because that's what they were. They were a Motley Crue. And so when you suggest, when people say maybe they just stole the body, and there's a lot more than just this, but when you suggest that the disciples stole the body, what you're suggesting is this group of fishermen and tax collectors and people like that overpowered the Roman guard who had been put in place to guard the tomb. That's what you're suggesting. So who's reasonable? Okay? The second thing is that the tomb, we're told, was sealed with the Roman seal. Now, that's the Roman government seal, and if you break it, the punishment is very, very, very serious, up to and including execution. Execution, possibly, for the guards who let you break the seal, too. So this is all very serious. The Romans knew how to keep discipline and order, and it was often by killing people who got out of line. So, there's a Roman guard, and the tomb is sealed, okay? So that's one thing. Picture that tomb with a Roman guard in front of it. They're probably not standing at attention like this, right? Because that's not the duty. But there's a few guys hanging around. They've still got their armor on. They haven't left their swords far from their bodies because soldiers don't leave their weapons far from their bodies when they're on duty. And the tomb is sealed with the Roman seal, and your suggestion is that these ragtag group of people came and overpowered them and took their body. Who's reasonable? Now, we're also told that when they went and looked, and this is a kind of a strange little detail to include, actually, we're told that when the disciples went to look at the tomb, the burial clothes were there. We're told the burial clothes were there. And why would they leave the... Imagine yourself going to steal a body that's 2 days old of your beloved master in a culture where nakedness is shame. How many of you would unwrap the body and leave the burial clothes and carry him off naked, this two-day-old decaying bloody body? It adds credence. Each one of the things adds credence. The third thing we know is the character of the disciples. These are the disciples who all Friday fled in fear of their lives. These are the disciples who denied knowing Jesus. It's just not in the character of them to mount this kind of thing, to go steal the body of Jesus and then proclaim him risen, which is going to have more going on in a minute. So one thing, swim, S. Stolen body, nah. That's not really very reasonable way to discount this story, of which we are reasonably skeptical. Swim, stolen body. I forgot my Bible, which is stuck in there. Also, the tomb, I forgot to say, that the stone in front of the tomb is not, you don't just like two guys pick it up. It's a big deal because it's a tomb, right? They're sealing it up. So they've got several strong people with like big poles and levers, and they have to roll this 1 to 2 ton stone in front of the body. So that's swim, S. Do they steal the body? Probably not. The second, some people have said they went to the wrong tomb. The women, they were grieving, they went to the wrong tomb, they came back, they said the tomb was empty, and so now everybody believes that Jesus has risen from the dead. Well, for my mind, that's a pretty unreasonable explanation. In fact, it sounds like grasping at straws to me, for a lot of reasons. One is we already have that Roman guard thing going on. The second is that Matthew tells us that the women watched the burial. Matthew 27:61. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. They watched Jesus being buried. They knew right where the tomb was. The third thing is, they also knew whose tomb it was. It was a tomb that belonged to a particular guy with a particular name. And remember, when this was written, this is just somebody's account of what happened. It wasn't the Bible for a long time. We're going to get to that in a moment. They knew it was a tomb that belonged to a guy named Joseph of Arimathea. Joseph, the guy whose tomb it was, with some help, came and took the body, wrapped it in a linen shroud, and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had cut in the rock, and they rolled the great stone in the entrance of the tomb, and they went away. So, swim. Did they steal the body? Probably not. Was it the wrong tomb? The wrong tomb. I think that's enough of an argument right there. Come on. The wrong tomb? Please. That's really, I don't know what that is, but But anyway, okay, so maybe they stole the body, maybe it's the wrong machine, maybe they just invented the whole thing. And that kind of goes with stolen the body. But let's talk about that from the angle of making up the story. So the first thing is, they would have to steal the body to invent the myth, right? Because if you said Jesus rose and you didn't steal the body, what are the religious leaders going to do? They're just going to go get it, right? They're going to get Pilate's, they're going to get the governor's permission to slice that seal open. And then they're going to slice that seal open, they're going to roll that stone away, and they're going to bring the decomposing body of Jesus out into the streets and say, they're saying he's raised, and we are holding his body, who's right? Okay, that inventing thing is pretty easy to dispel. The second thing is if they invented this, to what end did they invent it? Because they held on to this story forever. They held on to the story to the end of their lives. They were imprisoned. They were beaten. They were stoned. All but one of the 12, well, one of the 11, was martyred, was killed, saying that they saw Jesus after he died, that Jesus rose, and they trust him so much they are willing to simply let themselves be killed rather than deny they saw Jesus. So the idea that these people just invented it is not very reasonable. One person might go crazy, but hundreds. And then what about the guy named Saul, who was trying to persecute the church, who was trying to stamp it out, and then had some experience of the risen Christ? He was on a road to Damascus. He had secured letters from the leaders in Jerusalem to go arrest Christians in Damascus and bring them back to Jerusalem to be tried, tortured, whatever, who knows. And so there he was, riding to Damascus, and then some bright light knocked him off his horse, and some voice out of the light said, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Paul said, who are you? And the voice said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. And then, you know what Jesus did then? He didn't ask Saul any more questions. He didn't say, so let's talk. He didn't say, tell me what you're feeling. He said, now go. I'm going to tell you exactly what you're going to have to do. And you know what Paul did? He went, because he encountered the living Christ. The guy who was trying to stamp out the church became the church's greatest proponent. The guy who was trying to get rid of Jesus ends up trying to convince people of Jesus. That is strong evidence. That's like a hostile witness turning. So that's SWM. Did they steal the body? Probably not. Wrong tomb? Really? Come on. Invented it? To what end? What did they gain? What's in it with it, right? What's in it for me by inventing this story and holding on to it to my death? And then M. This is another one. Some people say that maybe... I probably have that little list back in there. I don't. Anyway. So the M, swim. Did they steal the body? No. Seems unlikely upon examination of the evidence. Was it the wrong tomb? That seems like grasping at straws. Did they invent this story? To what end? They all held on to it for decades and died with it on their lips. The M is the idea that this whole thing got mythologized later. That there was a guy named Jesus, and he lived, and he died, and his life had such an impact on people that they began to think about him in a different way, and began to think about his life, and began to embellish his life. That's what the mythologizing is. And certainly this does happen, but the problem is that, one, there are just two problems. And the first is that the way the disciples wrote about it, because that's what the Bible is. Remember, the Bible didn't drop out of heaven. The Bible wasn't God saying, here's my book. The Bible is a collection of what people of written accounts of what people experienced and what people were teaching other people about what they experienced. So, the first thing is, when we read the Bible, it does not read like something somebody made up. It doesn't read like myths. Let me read a myth to you. Here's the way a myth starts. Sing in me, muse, and tell me the story of that man skilled in all ways of contending, the wanderer, harried for years on end after he plundered the stronghold on the proud height of Troy. That's from approximately the same era, within a few hundred years. That's the Odyssey. Here's another one, just kind of getting in mind how these sort of mythical tales begin. The beginning of Beowulf. Lo, the spear Dane's glory through splendid achievements, the folk king's former fame we have heard of, how princes displayed then their prowess of battle. This is the way mythological tales begin. In a hole in the ground, there lived a hobbit. One of my favorite mythological tales. Or, one with which lots of you are familiar, a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away. So picture all these things in your mind. This is the way they begin, right? This is one time in a faraway land, deep in the heart of the forest, there lived, one time a man walked the earth, or something like this. Now read the Gospels. Read the way the disciples write. Inasmuch as many have undertaken, this is the Gospel of Luke. Luke was a person who sat down to write an account long before the Bible ever existed. And this is what he wrote to anybody who would read his writing, especially this guy named Theophilus. Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, seemed good to me also, having followed everything very closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. Does that sound like the beginning of a myth to you? Does that sound like the beginning of a tale, of a wonderful tale? It's not. That's not. You could argue whether Luke was deranged or something, but you can't argue on what he was intending to do when he wrote. How about this one? This is Luke a little later. He says, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, Pontius Pilate being the governor of Judea, Herod being the tetrarch of Galilee, and his brother Philip, tetrarch of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Licinius, the tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priest of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. Does it sound like John is trying to get you to see that he's being specific? If you are making something up or mythologizing something, is this what you do? Well, this guy was. This is not what you do. In case you needed an answer to that, this guy was king. This guy was governor. These guys were tetrarchs. This is the way things were dated back then. By the way, this is the equivalent of saying on May 29th, 2014, this is what happened to me. That's what this is. This is the most solid dating you could possibly imagine. Luke is intending to tell us he's not making it up. It's not a story. It's not a fairy tale. This is what happened, and I've researched it, and this is what eyewitnesses have told me. Okay? So the idea that it's mythologized goes against the style of writing and the assertions of the authors in the text itself. And then... So they didn't invent it, they pinned it in history. These kind of two sort of, the evidence kind of dovetails. Clearly they didn't invent it, because you're not going to say in the reign of this person, when you invent something, because you don't want to pin it down. You need to leave it loose. And especially if you're making a mythology out of it. So what if the things got embellished later? Well, I think, two things. One is I think we need to acknowledge the possibility that there has been embellishment. Because things do get embellished. Things do get embellished. Things get changed. Things get altered a little bit. Stories change. Anyone ever played telephone? That kid's game where you say a sentence in someone's ear, and then they whisper to the next person, they whisper to the next person, they whisper to the next person, right? And it comes out different. Okay, those things happen. Anyone ever heard a fish story? The fish gets bigger and bigger and bigger every time you tell about the one that got away, right? So I think we have to acknowledge the human tendency to embellish things that are important to us, or change them or add them. But let's talk about whether or not this was mythologized and embellished. This is Thessalonians 1, verse 10. Thessalonians, by its harshest critics, is acknowledged to have been written no later than about 51 AD or CE, depending on which date and system you like. So, assuming Jesus died in about 29 or 30 AD, CE, and this was written 20 years later, 20 years is not very long in historical times. And here is what Paul said when he's writing to the churches in Thessalonica, that this is the core of what we're doing, to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus who delivers us from the wrath to come. So it's the idea that he was raised from the dead is smack dab in the middle of the very first letter written. But the first letter written is not necessarily the first thing written. The scholars who try to tease these things out have looked through this book, 1 Corinthians, and they believe that this little snippet here was kind of Cliff's notes on the whole thing. Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures. He was buried and he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. And he appeared to Peter and then to the 12. That's what they made everybody memorize or whatever. They even call it a hymn. And I don't know what that means. But the scholars who try to tease this out with the language and everything believe that this particular phrase, as it's written, probably developed within a handful of years, 2, 3, 5 years at the outside, from the death of Christ, as everybody began to follow him, because he was raised from the dead. So swim. Can you guys do those four things with me? You think you can get them? S? Stolen, right? Stolen body, probably not. W? Wrong too? Yeah, probably not. Invented it? To what end? And then mythologized later? Not enough time. It's too early. It's just too early, it's too quick. And it's too impactful. There is no explanation for the spreading like wildfire of this idea unless Jesus was actually raised. All that stuff is in your sermon handout, by the way. So our faith, the Christian faith, is in the risen Christ. This is what we believe. This is what we cling to. The world doesn't always make sense to us. Our prayers feel like they're answered. Sometimes they feel like they're ignored. But the core of our faith is that Jesus rose from the dead. And here's what I want to tell you. And this is the thing. We made it. You guys all stayed for the end. This is the thing that some people are going to go, duh. Some people are going to feel a little unsettled by. And some people are going to feel relieved by it. Be a Christian without the Bible. The assertion that Jesus was raised predates the Bible. The Bible, as we walk around and hold it and say, the Bible tells me so, is from somewhere between 1 and 200 AD. 150 to 280 AD, or 200 AD, even maybe. It's from quite a long time. People were talking about the resurrection of Christ long before there was a Bible. So you don't need the Bible. And in fact, the thing that a lot of people get tripped up on, and this is what I really want to say that's gonna send people in different directions. The doctrine of the inerrancy of Scriptures, that the Bible is the Bible without mistake, is not a primary doctrine of the Christian Church. It's been disputed and looked at all different ways, just like what the cross did has been talked about in all different ways. What the Church has universally said is the Scriptures are trustworthy. Not that they are inherent. Here's what it looks like. The Bible is to Jesus as a birth certificate is to a baby. If you can't find the birth certificate, that does not mean the baby isn't there. Can you go with me there? Is that okay? Everybody agree with that? If you can't find the birth certificate, it doesn't mean the baby wasn't born, right? And so if you don't have the Bible, it doesn't mean that Jesus wasn't raised, because they didn't have the Bible for the first 200 years after Jesus was raised. And yet, faith in Christ spread like crazy. And so what I want to tell you, and this is, it's going to be unsettling to some people and dull to some people, and it's going to help some people relax, is you do not have to believe in the inerrancy of Scripture. You don't have to believe the Bible is the inspired Word of God to believe that Jesus came out of the tomb. Because there's a lot of things in the Bible that are harder to believe and that people struggle with. There's a lot of different ways to read the Bible. There's this book of Job that talks about Satan going around the earth looking at everybody, and it goes up to God and he says, you know what, I can turn anybody. And God says, oh yeah, what about Job? And Satan says, I can get Job. And God says, go to it, because you can't touch his body. And so Satan goes down and he does all sorts of things to Job, and this is a whole other sermon, I'm just telling you the story. And then Job doesn't curse God, and Satan goes back to God and says, well, I could get him to curse you if you let me actually touch his body. So God says, I don't think so, go to it. And so Satan, you know, causes blows and stuff, and painfulness. And finally, Job questions God, and Job has friends come. It's worth reading, because Job's friends come with all these explanations about why bad things are happening to God, to Job. They come with all the explanations, and in the end, what happens is Job finally cries out, why is this happening? I deserve to be able to question God. And then God shows up and starts questioning Job, and Job shuts his mouth and says, I think I was a little bit arrogant to think I could stand before you, and he just sort of repents. And then God yells at Job's three friends for trying to explain away the bad things that are happening to Job by referring to Job's behavior. Because the core of what they all say is this: Job, bad things don't happen to people unless they do bad things. What have you done that has caused this to happen to you? What sin are you hiding that all this calamity has happened to you? And God shows up in the story and says, that is false. That is not at all what happened. And in fact, you guys are all going to die unless Job prays for you. Now, some people believe that actually happened. Some people believe it didn't happen, but it's a story with deep and powerful meaning for our lives about suffering, where it comes from, what it means, and what it doesn't mean. And it's okay that some people think that really happened, and some people think it didn't. You know why it's okay? Because the Bible is like the birth certificate, and Jesus is Jesus. That's why it's okay. Jesus rose from the dead. That's the core of the whole thing, is that Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus rose again. Everything else is secondary doctrine. Our faith is in God. And I am not trying to pull the Bible down here, because the Bible is our scripture, and it is true and reliable, and that can mean different things for different people. But what it means for everybody is you don't get to pick and choose what you want of it. What I'm trying to do here is put Christ back where he belongs. Because sometimes you're going to read the Bible and you're going to go, wow, I don't know if I can believe this Christian faith. And you can question the Bible without questioning Jesus. That's what I really want to tell you. I want to tell you that Jesus rose from the dead. We already talked about the evidence. And it's strong enough. I mean, it's not ironclad, right? Who knows? Nothing's ironclad. Did anyone ever read Descartes? Descartes is the one who tried to figure out what you can actually know for sure, for sure, for sure. And he went out to a cabin in France, and he thought, and he thought, and he thought, and this is what he came up with. And you're going to recognize this. I think, therefore I am. I think, therefore I am. And what his conclusion was, that the thing I can know for absolute certain is that even if I am deceived in every detail of my life, even if I misunderstand everything, missee everything, even if I exist in a world where there is a God around me who is purposely deceiving me at all points, I have to exist in order to be deceived. I have to exist in order to be deceived. Why am I saying that? It's interesting, isn't it? The second thing is that that what I would like for you is to be open. Open to Christ moving in you and convincing you of his resurrection. That's what I would like. And I think the evidence is strong enough that each of us here should be truly open in our hearts to the risen Christ coming to us and moving in us and working through us to do his redemptive work in the world. Because God loves people, and God loves you, and God wants to love other people through you. And so, the resurrection. Resurrection is the crux of everything. And now I would like to, I just want to take a moment to pray together as we close out the sermon time. Father, we have talked over these few weeks about the table of fellowship and the cross where your love is shown, and the empty tomb where your power is shown, and where we're shown that what Jesus taught is ultimately trustworthy, even at the point of death itself. Because you showed us that you are the master over death, and that Jesus broke the bonds and chains of death. Help us to trust you through Jesus above all things. We might misunderstand what the Bible said. We might get things wrong. We will get things wrong. Let me assume that, God. We will get things wrong. But what we know and what we can trust above anything is your love for us, the fellowship you want with us through the table, the forgiveness you give us in the cross, and your power to work right now in our lives in the end continuum. Christ, make yourself known to us as the risen Lord of the universe that you are. In Jesus' name, in your name, Christ. Amen. We'll take a short break. Chance for you to think, stretch, whatever you need to do. See if you can remember the SWIM acronym without looking and talk your way through it, because that's going to help you. And then think about these things. Does it change the way your faith is?